So please join me in welcoming Deke Dickerson.
Thank you very much, Steve. First, I want to say it's a huge honor and a big thrill for me to be invited to do this. The Southern Folklife Collection is sort of unparalleled in what they have available to researchers like myself, but I'm going to get around to that a little bit later on. I'm assuming if you're tuning into this that you know a little bit about who Merle Travis was, but if you are a complete newbie, I'll just go over a few of the basics. He is a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame. He's an iconic country performer, entertainer, singer, songwriter, guitar player. He sort of perfected and popularized a style of Kentucky thumb picking that now bears his name. It's called Travis picking. He wrote a couple of huge hits that became sort of iconic folk standards. One is called 16 Tons. The other one is called Dark as a Dungeon. He wrote other hit songs like Smoke, Smoke, Smoke That Cigarette. He came up with a number of guitar-related inventions. He was just a very, very sharp-thinking guy. And among his other talents, he was a fantastic cartoonist and, watch repairman. The guy was a certified genius. So just a bit about how I came to write this book. I'm a guitar player, as Steve mentioned. Thank you, Steve. And I also have done quite a bit of writing about, you know, famous musicians and music. And it began to eat away at me that there was no Merle Travis biography out there. What made it especially strange is that Merle was known for being sort of the most literary country music guy of his time. He wrote articles for country music magazines. He wrote liner notes for albums. He was just known as a very good writer. And so it rubbed me the wrong way. Like, why isn't there a Merle Travis book out there for all of us to read and enjoy? I eventually stumbled across his two living daughters who live in Southern California, although Cindy, the youngest daughter, now lives in North Carolina. I should give that shout out. And I would run into Merlene and Cindy, his daughters, at various events here in Southern California where I live. And I started asking them, I said, why isn't there a book about your dad? I said, there really should be a book about your dad. And eventually, I guess I sort of wore away on their resistance enough so that they decided that was a good idea. What I did not know was that after Merle died, all of his stuff was taken care of by his last wife, Dorothy. And when she died in the early 1990s, Merlene and Cindy brought all of Merle's, everything he had collected over his lifetime and put it in a storage unit in Santa Barbara. The storage unit basically was untouched for 30 years. And then Cindy began going through it and organizing a lot of the stuff. And that's when they brought me in. And it really was kind of like seeing the King Tut's tomb of country music opened up. It was incredible because we'll get into this a little bit later. Merle was a very bad alcoholic. He had a lot of drug problems. He was married at least 5 times. He moved around a lot. So the fact that he was able to save thousands and thousands of photographs, thousands of letters, little scraps of paper, posters, all these things that were important to his career, the fact that he was able to save those things was nothing short of a miracle. And in that stuff, Cindy discovered that he had started to write an autobiography. It was about 80 to 100 pages of just raw, unedited writing. Some of it written in the 1960s, most of it written in the 1970s. So he had tried to get that process going, but he never put it together. He never edited it. And nothing in his writings happened after 1955. So it was very incomplete, but it was something. And I took that to my friend Scott Bomar at BMG Books. And I pitched the book to him. I said, look, you know, we've got this undiscovered, unpublished autobiographical writing. And this is a very, very important figure in country music history, as well as guitar history. There needs to be a Merle Travis book. Now, luckily, Scott agreed with me. And so I went to work in 2018. And I'm gonna fly in some photos whenever I can here. Here's a photo of Merle Travis in his prime with his 1948 Bigsby guitar. That's sort of Merle at the height of his popularity. And so this was what I had to start with, was this wonderful image of Merle Travis, the country music star, with his Bigsby solid body electric guitar. So when I first started work on the book, I realized that there were 7 or 8 people who were all in their 90s that I needed to interview right away. So that was the very, very first thing, as I went to people like Rosalie Mathis, who was 96 at the time. She has since passed away. Herb Remington, who was a steel guitar player that played with Bob Wills, who also played with Merle Travis in the mid-1940s in Los Angeles. I interviewed him. He has since passed away. There was quite a few of these people that I was lucky enough to sit down with and interview just right at the tail end of their lives. And so that was the first thing that I did to start work on the book. I eventually did about 70 interviews for the book. I tried to interview everybody that was still alive that actually had some sort of interaction with Merle, whether it was professionally or just as a friend. Or I even interviewed a guy who was a kid in the trailer park where Merle lived in the 1970s. And he had, all kinds of stories about Merle in the 1970s. So I tried to interview as many people as I could. And the main thing that kept going through my mind as I did the research for this book is, you're only going to have one opportunity to write this book. There's not going to be a second Merle Travis book. So it has to be done right. It has to be very thorough. It has to be very complete. No stone unturned. And the other thing that I'm very grateful for is that Merlene and Cindy, his daughters, they told me, they said, look, you have to tell the whole story. It can't be a glossy, happy, friendly story, because Merle Travis and his life and his career, they had two sides to it. There were extreme highs, genius level abilities, tremendous successes. And then there was also a real history of alcoholism and pill abuse and setting himself on fire in a hotel room, a shootout with the police in 1956. These are all detailed in the book if you want all those juicy stories. But I was very lucky that Merlene and Cindy told me, you have to tell the whole story, good and bad. Luckily, I'm a traveling musician. I tour around for my job. So that made it somewhat easy to go and visit a lot of these people on my travels. And, I would bring along my laptop and a scanner and try to get really high resolution scans of these photos. In 2018, I made a trip mostly to Kentucky. I wanted to spend sort of a week in Muhlenberg County, Kentucky, where Merle was from, and do research on the Muhlenberg County guitar style, as well as Merle's early history. But just as a side note to that, I also drove kind of in a big circle. I went to Mississippi. I went up to Cincinnati. I went to Nashville. And then I also drove about 600 miles out of my way to meet the daughter of Jenny Cushman, who was Merle's cornet player and girlfriend in 1946, 1947, just so that I could get a really good high-res scan of this very important picture. I might as well show this picture now since I'm talking about it. Yeah, I drove 600 miles out of my way just so that I could get a really, really nice high-res scan of Merle, Jenny Cushman, and the very, very first iteration of his 1948 Bigsby guitar. As you can see, it's got a different headstock and it has no cutaway. All these kind of little details are talked about in the book quite extensively. So getting back to Kentucky, Merle Travis was from Ebenezer, Kentucky. Actually, he was born in Rosewood, Kentucky, a few miles down the road. This is in Muhlenberg County, Kentucky, which really, it's just an isolated part of the state that was most famous for coal. And Muhlenberg County, up until the 1970s or the 1980s, was where the majority of coal in the United States was mined. And as we know, with 16 Tons and Dark as a Dungeon and many of Merle's later songs, the coal mining aspect of his childhood and upbringing was very important to him. Like a lot of rural people living in the early part of the 20th century. His family was very poor. You know, they lived in a shack with no electricity, no paint on the wood, no running water, any of that kind of stuff. But there was a lot of music. And, you know, he talks extensively in interviews about having this wind-up Victrola, and they would get records in whenever they could, which was quite a thing in the early part of the 20th century. People would mail order these records. And so even though Merle grew up in this rural, very isolated town, he was able to hear, you know, Sousa marches and pop records and jazz records and hillbilly records and Hawaiian guitar records and things like that. One of the most fascinating things for me about getting to write this book was getting to write basically a chapter about the history of the Muhlenberg County guitar style. And if you're not familiar with it, it's a really sort of unique regional thing. And again, you know, going back to the pre-internet era, the pre-television era, there were all these different regional music styles. You know, you can think of Delta blues down in the deep South. You can think about, you know, New Orleans jazz, things like that. But one of the most unusual to me was the advent of the Muhlenberg County thumb-picking style of guitar. What made it unusual, and maybe I should grab a guitar. I know that Stephen really wanted me to demonstrate some guitar, even though I will state right now that I am not a Travis picker. I'm not really a thumb picker. But the guitar for the early part of its life was played with a flat pick like that, or a plectrum, and people strummed chords on it, you know, like this. You know, that was how the Spanish style of guitar was played. Later on, a lot of African-American blues musicians began playing with their fingers, usually with no picks, and, you know, kind of like a sort of a finger picking, sort of a thumb picking style. Of course, I'm playing horribly this morning. But what was unusual about the Merle Travis, the Muhlenberg County style is that all of a sudden there was this one county in the middle of rural Kentucky where there was this highly sophisticated style of thumb picking that used a celluloid thumb pick. And there were these guys like Mose Rager, Ike Everly, Kennedy Jones, and then of course Merle Travis, who became absolutely phenomenal with this style. And I went to Kentucky and I sort of did a deep dive on this Muhlenberg County guitar style. And for the person who is completely uninitiated to this, it's almost like a piano where the thumb acts like the left hand of a piano, and then the first finger and sometimes the second finger act as the right hand of a piano. So the thumb just kind of does. And then when you add the first finger, it becomes sort of a melody on top of that. I know we have some real guitar players out there watching, so I apologize for that. But the Muhlenberg County guitar style was generally credited to Kennedy Jones' mother, who was the first one to play in that style in Muhlenberg County. And again, as I mentioned, a lot of people were playing with their thumb and their finger at that time. It's difficult to say exactly when it happened, but at some point, all this sort of chordal knowledge and going all the way up and down the neck, lots of very sophisticated stuff, not only with hillbilly music, blues, jazz, pop, you know, Dixieland, it all began incorporating into this Muhlenberg County style. Kennedy Jones was credited as being the first guy to go into a music store and see one of these celluloid thumb picks, which were primarily used for, you know, banjo and I guess auto harp and things like that, and say, hey, I want to use that with the guitar. And his interview that I got, he said that the guy at the music store told him, no, you don't use those for guitar. But he bought a bunch of them anyway, and he started playing with it. And that inspired guys who were coming up at the time, like Mose Rager, Mose Rager took a toothbrush and bent it with heat to make his first thumb pick. But they all started using these thumb picks and developing this style. Mose Rager and Ike Everly were probably the two guys that influenced Merle Travis the most. Mose Rager is a guy that most of you have probably never heard of. He was a barber there in Muhlenberg County. And he did play professionally a little bit with people like Grandpa Jones and Curly Fox and Texas Ruby, but he didn't like the professional musician lifestyle, so he mostly stayed in Kentucky. Merle always gave him a lot of credit. And then Ike Everly, of course, was the father of Don and Phil, the Everly brothers. And between the two of those guys, Mose Rager and Ike Everly, they just completely warped Merle Travis's mind. As a young lad, he would go around and watch them play on people's porches, and he would try to copy them. And everybody said that Merle just picked the stuff up super fast. And before you know it, Merle became the guy that played better than all the rest of them. I'm going to put my guitar down now, and I'm going to pull up one photo. As I mentioned, Merlene and Cindy saved all these photos, and it was really a treasure trove of unreleased photos. The one that I'm going to show now, this one just blew me away when I found it. This is Merle. I'm guessing he's probably about 12 or 13 years old there. And, you know, when they say that a picture is worth a thousand words, this photo really encapsulates that for me, because you can just see the serious look on his face. These guys in Kentucky were very, very serious about their guitar playing. They did not joke around about it. They wanted to be really, really good, and they tried to outdo each other. And that's, I think, one of the reasons why the Muhlenberg County style became so sophisticated. But you can see that he's got the thumb pick on in his right hand. He's got the right, you know, he's got the correct right hand angle going. But then most amazingly to me is if you look at the left hand, he's playing the extremely difficult to play Mose Rager E7th chord, you know, and he's 12 or 13 years old there. You can see his thumb wrapped around the top of the neck. That is an extremely difficult chord to make for anybody. I'll show you on my guitar when I get it off, but this photo just blew me away when I saw it. It's like, there he is. He's 12, 13 years old, and he is already just extremely serious about his guitar playing. So I know we have some guitar pickers out there, and they can correct me if I'm wrong here, but this is your basic E7 chord that you play in Cannonball Rag. And then the Mose Rager E7 chord is when you wrap your thumb over the top and play the fifth and the sixth string. See, I can't do it right. I can't make the strings ring out properly. But that's it, you know, and Merle at age 12 has already got that left-hand claw just going on it. So the study of the Muhlenberg County guitar style almost takes up an entire chapter, and it was a really kind of fascinating story. I should also mention before I move on that Mose Rager, Ike Everly, Kennedy Jones were sort of the main guys that started it all. There was another African-American guitar player and fiddler, a guy named Arnold Schutz, who some people credited with being the guy who influenced all the later thumb pickers. He definitely was an influence, but I don't think that he was the guy who brought in the thumb picking. He mostly played slide-style guitar. And he played fiddle. He was an influence to Bill Monroe and the bluesy side of bluegrass. Bill Monroe was from the next county over from Muhlenberg County. And so Arnold Schutz, you know, was around. But Arnold Schutz, I think, was a guy who brought in sort of the sophisticated jazz chord phrasing to a lot of this stuff. And the last thing I'll say about the Muhlenberg County guitar style is that it doesn't exist anywhere else. You know, this sophisticated level of jazz chord playing, you know, the all the different genres of music all together. So Arnold Schütz definitely had something to do with that. Okay, I'm already running late, so I'm going to talk very quickly now. Merle left Kentucky when he was 17 years old, and he went up to Cincinnati, which at the time was sort of the center of American broadcasting. There was a station in Cincinnati called WLW that was run by Powell Crosley. If you see those kind of cheap record players now that say Crosley on them, it's part of the same name. Back then, you know, he owned this WLW radio station. He also owned the Cincinnati Reds baseball team. He made Crosley cars. You know, he was a multimillionaire. And for a few years in the late 1930s, when Merle first moved there, WLW was the only 500,000-watt station in the United States. It only lasted for a couple of years because, you know, like the radio would come in on people's fillings and it would vibrate siding off the sides of barns and things like that. But that was the sort of center of the broadcasting universe that Merle moved to in 1937. I'm going to show a quick picture. This is the first. He worked with a couple groups before this, but he left Kentucky so that he could join Clayton McMichin's band. And you can see Merle there just to the left, our right of Clayton McMichin there is a very young 17-year-old kid. And from there, he joined a group called the Drifting Pioneers that also worked on WLW in Cincinnati. This was during the late 1930s, early 1940s. He began playing the electric guitar then, and when World War II came out, a lot of the people there at WLW were getting drafted. Merle, his first wife, his first marriage was kind of a failure, and he was looking for a way out, so he enlisted in the Marines in 1943. They sent him home after 6 weeks. Now, there was so much mystery and confusion about his military service that I actually looked up to see if you could just pay some money and get his military records. And surprisingly, you could send in $70 and get anybody's military records, even if you weren't family. And I believe I was the first one to ever access Merle's military records. And they basically deemed him unsuitable for service. They just sent him straight home. They just said, you're no good here. But there were also some interesting details about his mental health. You know, they said that he had some sort of psychological problem that caused him to drink, and said that he, you know, had been institutionalized. All very vague stuff, but it was fascinating to discover that after 80 years of being in the you know, buried in some record somewhere in the government. So after they threw him out of the military, he came back to Cincinnati, and the marriage was basically over with his first wife. So he took a tip from Western actor Smiley Burnett, who was playing in Cincinnati, and he just borrowed $10 from everybody there at WLW and took a train to Los Angeles because he heard that, you know, there was tons of work. You know, Smiley Burnett told him that he'd rather eat lettuce in California than caviar in Cincinnati. And so Merle just went out there, and it was basically sort of a lucky accident. And there's a number of times in Merle's career where he just kind of stumbled into some situation right at the right time, moving to Cincinnati when they were a 500,000 watt station is one example. Moving to Los Angeles in 1944 is another example, because at that time, Los Angeles was exploding. There was all these Okies and Arkies and Texans and Missourians that had moved out there that were working in the defense plants. There was so much going on in Los Angeles that all these defense plants were working 24-hour, you know, 3 8-hour shifts. And so the musicians could actually play swing shift dances where they could, you know, play at 8 in the morning when that shift got off, and they could play in the afternoon when that shift got off, and then they could play at night when that shift got off. So there was a ton of work, and Merle, being very talented, just immediately fell into that. He He got a few breaks. He befriended Tex Ritter and Gene Autry and was in a bunch of sort of low-budget Western movies during the mid to late 1940s. And that's where he met a lot of the people that would be very influential in his life for the rest of his life. People like Tex Ritter and Gene Autry, also the Sons of the Pioneers, just all these old Western guys. They were all working there in Los Angeles in the mid to late 1940s. But here is a still from a 1945 Soundy film that he made with an all-female band, as you can see, that's Carolina Cotton next to him. And you can see a number of these on YouTube, which is a wonderful thing that, you know, wasn't the case 10 or 20 years ago. Now we can see a photo like this, go to YouTube, and instantly it comes to life. But he was recognized as a very talented individual and began playing on recording sessions for people like Tex Ritter and Wesley Tuttle and people like that. And it wasn't very long before Clippy Stone at Capitol Records decided to sign Merle to Capitol Records. First as a artist recording guitar instrumentals and vocals for their Capitol Transcription Service. That was in 1945 and 1946. Then in 1946, he became a full-fledged Capitol recording artist. Capitol Records is still one of the biggest record labels in the world, but at the time, they had just gotten started a couple years earlier, and they realized that hillbilly music was very popular. They were trying to do it all at the time, but pop and jazz and that sort of things weren't selling very well, but country music was selling like mad. So Merle Travis signed with the label and quickly had a string of very popular at the time hits like Divorce Me, COD, I Like My Chicken Frying Size, No Vacancy, etc., things like that. And the period of 1946 to 1948, he became a full-fledged country music star in Los Angeles. Around that same time, 1947, 1948, Clippy Stone asked him to record an album of folk music songs. At the time, groups like the Weavers and Burl Ives were having some success with folk music, and Merle thought it was a really dumb idea. He did not want to do it, but Clippy just said, well, write some stuff that sounds like old folk songs. And so, you know, under duress, Merle very quickly wrote songs like 16 Tons and Dark as a Dungeon, which came out on this 78 RPM album called Folk Songs from the Hills. This album was a complete flop when it was released, but then several years later, and I'm going to start skipping ahead here so we can make up lost time. A few years later, 16 Tons was covered by Timothy Ernie Ford and became the number one song of 1955. There's a picture of Merle and Tennessee Ernie, and they were very good friends. As you can see, having a number one hit, that eases a lot of pain. But this song, 16 Tons, I want to get into that just a little bit later, but it was more than just a hit record. It was sort of like a phenomenon. It turned on a lot of people to this idea of songs about the working class, songs about, you know, struggle, songs about, you know, normal people, as opposed to, you know, fantasy type songs that were so popular in pop music and things like that. I'm running out of time. I really want to talk about the Bigsby solid body electric guitar. Merle was out in Hollywood in the 1940s and began playing with several lap steel guitar players and console steel guitar players, including a guy named Joaquin Murphy. Now, Joaquin Murphy was sort of a eccentric genius. He was the best. Even today, a lot of steel guitar players acknowledge that he was probably the best non-pedal steel guitar player that ever lived. And he played this solid maple steel guitar made by a guy named Paul Bigsby. Merle eventually befriended Paul Bigsby through motorcycle races that were happening in a place called Lincoln Park, sort of near downtown in Los Angeles. And Paul Bigsby was a country music fan, and he also liked country music. So once Merle and Paul Bigsby got together, they became good friends with, you know, bonding on motorcycles. Merle was into motorcycles. He had an Indian Chief. And then eventually Merle had this idea. He said, why can't I have a solid guitar made out of solid wood that sustains like a steel guitar, but is played in the regular style? So he went to Paul Bigsby and he said, this is what I want you to do. And I need to back up. He did not go to Paul Bigsby. Paul Bigsby came to one of his radio broadcasts. And in several interviews, Merle talked about, well, I grabbed a sheet of radio station paper and I turned it over and I started making drawings about the kind of guitar that I wanted Paul Bigsby to make me. Probably the most astounding discovery of this whole book, when I was going through all the stuff that was in the storage unit saved by Merlene and Cindy, there was a folder of cartoons. And I'll just break for a minute here. I know I'm running out of time. Merle was an avid cartoonist. He, at one point, wanted to be a professional cartoonist. And he did cartoons for several different magazines and booklets and things like that. I'm going to show one example of his cartoon work here. I love this one. This is, as you can see, this is a cartoon of a guy playing his ass off. So Cindy had compiled this folder of cartoons, and I was looking through all these Merle Travis cartoons. And then all of a sudden, I'm looking at this, and I'm looking through the book of cartoons, and all of a sudden, I see two sheets of paper, and I'm like, wait a minute, what is that? I'm looking at this piece of paper, and I said, that looks like the original drawing for the Bigsby guitar. And this is reproduced in the book. You can see it in the book. I'm going to show the second page. The thing that made this such an incredible find is that Merle talked about making these drawings for Paul Bigsby in dozens of interviews. He talked about making these drawings for Paul Bigsby to build a solid body guitar. What Merle never mentioned is that he saved the drawing. And sure enough, on the flip side of these two pieces of paper, it's a mimeographed thing for the radio show that he was on at the time, a radio show that Cliffy Stone produced called the Dinner Bell Roundup. So just in this folder of cartoons, there's these sketches for the Bigsby guitar. When the Bigsby guitar was finished by Paul Bigsby in May of 1948, it was so revolutionary that nobody really took it seriously. I mean, you know, it was a solid chunk of guitar when all other acoustic and electric guitars were hollow boxes, you know, that were carved tops and flat tops, but that were acoustic instruments. And this one had virtually no acoustic sound, but it did have an electric pickup on it. And Merle played it around for a little bit. And within a year or two, two other people that were living in Los Angeles at the time began manufacturing very influential solid body electric guitars. Leo Fender, who borrowed the Bigsby guitar for a week, came out with the Fender Telecaster and later the Fender Stratocaster, which I believe are maybe the two most famous electric guitar designs of all time. And then Les Paul, who was a very famous jazz and pop radio guitar player, also signed to Capitol Records, also living in Los Angeles at the time, came out with the Gibson Les Paul solid body guitar in 1952. And if you overlay the Bigsby guitar of Merle Travis and the Gibson Les Paul, the body shape is identical. So this one guitar that Merle had the concept for in 1948 became this template for everything that came after it. And I write about this very extensively in the book. So if you're interested in that history, there's quite a bit more that I don't have time to get into here today. So I guess I should get into a little bit, just saying that, you know, Merle was a genius. Everybody that knew him really loved him and thought that he was a genius. One thing that was really difficult to navigate was just how difficult his addictions were. He was an alcoholic since he was around the age of 12 or 13 years old, like a serious alcoholic. And it was one of the reasons why the military didn't accept him. And, you know, of course, this is nothing knew. Rosalie Mathis told me, she said, look, that was just the era where if you had to go to a meeting, you would go meet in a bar. You know, it was just everybody drank back then. And country guitar players in particular, I think every single one of them was an alcoholic back in that era. That's just kind of the way it was. But, you know, Merle was really, really bad in that regard and had a number of marriages end. And, you know, there was a famous shootout in 1956 that basically was him brandishing a gun and then passing out on his couch. And then the entire, you know, LAPD shows up around his house with a big barricade and made all the news stories all across the country because he had recently found this enormous fame being the songwriter of 16 Tons. Johnny Cash moved to Los Angeles in 1958. Within a very short time, Merle Travis and Johnny Cash became best friends and pill addicts. Merle became addicted to Tylenol, and the two of those guys together were just, and they were a really, really, really bad influence on each other. And Merle almost died in 1961. He rotted away his stomach from all the Tylenols, and he had a mass hemorrhage in his bed and had to be rushed to the hospital. He almost died. All these kind of stories are detailed in the book. He never really got clean. He would have periods of getting clean. And, you know, during those periods, he wrote quite a bit. I'm going to show one picture. It kind of doesn't look like he's clean during this era, but this is from around 1965, 1966, when he had really cleaned himself up. He was doing quite a bit of writing at the time, and he was touring around in this camper RV with his wife, Betty. And there's a picture of him looking pretty haggard in the morning, playing ukulele in his pajamas. But anyway, I just wanted to mention that, you know, it was a difficult navigating the story of this very genius musician, singer, songwriter, cartoonist, creative person, and this person who had a lot of really, really bad demons. Well, I'm going to try to wrap this up in the next 4 minutes. It looks like we have 4 minutes. There was another guy, a guy named Ed Kahn, who wanted to write a book on Merle Travis, and he did a lot of research, a lot of interviews. But he never wrote the book, and then he passed away. One thing I want to mention before I run out of time is that I basically had finished the book. You know, I had finished writing the book, but there were still these holes in there, things that I couldn't quite figure out, you know, how this 10,000-piece jigsaw puzzle all fit together. And that's when I discovered that the Southern Folklife Collection there at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, had Ed Kahn's archives and also a guy named Archie Green's archives accessible to researchers like myself. And it was incredible because, you know, basically in the last 2 or 3 months of me finishing this book, I got access to all this Ed Kahn stuff, and he had interviewed all these people that, you know, had passed away. And so I was able to get a lot of really great quotes and everything from that. So I want to thank Ed for doing all that work. And also I want to thank the Southern Folklife Collection for making that stuff available. And I want to say to anybody else who's doing research on country music, folk music, Southern music, you need to check out their archives because they have a ton of stuff available to researchers and writers like myself. Now it looks like maybe I've got 2 or 3 minutes. So I just want to say that Merle kind of had a renaissance in his later years. He was, looked up to and revered by a lot of the younger musicians. In particular, the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band featured him and Doc Watson, another North Carolina guy, meeting each other and playing together for the first time on their early 1970s album, Will the Circle Be Unbroken, which became this platinum hit. It became this huge hit at that time and really kind of helped bring about a renaissance for Merle's career with the folk music people and you know, hippies and things like that, audiences that he had never really played for before, you know, colleges, you know, sort of that sort of audience. And then eventually, you know, he started getting his due. He recorded an album with Chet Atkins in 1974 that won a Grammy. He was inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame in 1977, and he married this woman, Dorothy, who had been previously married to Hank Thompson, and he and Dorothy really hit it off. It was really like a nice ride off into the sunset. They were a perfect couple. They loved each other. They had a very happy last 5 years of his life, and he recorded a number of albums for CMH, and even though he died prematurely at the age of 65, he really did have a nice renaissance of his career in his later years. Let me see if I can pull up one or two more photos real quick. There's a nice picture of him and Chet Atkins in the studio for that album that won a Grammy in 1974. I'm going to pull up a photo of Merle and Roy Clark on Hee Haw in the early 1980s. This is right before Merle died. And here's a photo that I should definitely show of Johnny Cash, Marty Stewart, and Merle in the early 1980s. And I should add that Marty Stewart was a tremendous help on this book. He not only had a great anecdote about meeting Merle around this time, but he also contributed to writing the back of the book and all that. So I thank you, Marty, for that. He's always so good at that kind of a thing. I think we're at 9:45 if you guys want to interrupt me.